Okay, so thank you all very much indeed for coming. I think we can make a start now that all of our speakers are here. So my name's Jo Caseborn and I'm Director of Development here at the Institute for Government, and welcome to the Institute today for our discussion about mayors. Before we kick off, I'd like to thank Grant Thornton for their support for this series of three events on local leadership. And this is the second in that series of three, exploring today how will these new mayors that are going to be elected in May work with Whitehall to improve prospects for their city regions. So please do tweet and join in the conversation. The hashtag today is IFGMayors. So just a few introductory remarks from me before we kick off. Well, on the 4th of May, as many of you will know, there are going to be mayoral elections in six areas of England: Greater Manchester, the Liverpool City Region, Tees Valley, the West Midlands, Cambridgeshire and Peterborough, and the West of England. And we've argued here at the Institute that these new mayors are the best chance to date of real power and progress in decentralising power within England. And we've argued that these new mayors are very different from past attempts at mayors for five key reasons. The first is precisely because they're going to cover city regions rather than single local authorities, as we've seen with mayors in the past. So people don't just work and live in the area covered by, say, Liverpool City Council. They work and live across the whole of the Merseyside area, kind of commuting in and out. The second reason these new mayors are different is that they're going to provide visible, legitimate and accountable leadership. So citizens are going to know who the mayor of their local area is, and they're going to have visibility beyond the region. And someone who represents 3 or 4 million people is going to be recognised on the national stage and taken seriously by both national civil servants and politicians. Thirdly, these new mayors are going to be at the right spatial scale, and they're going to have that strategic focus. So achieving real change in local public services and indeed local growth means, again, working beyond a scale of a single local authority, and these mayors will be leaders of place rather than leaders of councils. And fourthly, they're going to be able to better wield what we've called soft power. So existing mayors already enjoy far better access to secretaries of state than do many MPs, and these mayors are also going to be able to convene local public service leaders in their area to sort out problems that require coordination. And fifthly and finally, they're going to be outward facing in their leadership. So that means they can go on trade missions, they can act as kind of figureheads for attracting inward investment in their areas. And also, mayors are a very good way of ensuring that devolution is sustainable over time, as we've seen in London. So I won't go into too much more detail because I know Tom is going to provide some of that in a minute. But the kind of questions that we want to explore on the panel today are: what difference are these new directly elected mayors going to make to public services growth and investment? How can they work constructively with Whitehall to ensure the best for their local areas? And how indeed does Whitehall need to adapt, and how do departments across Whitehall need to work differently in this kind of post-devolution landscape? And do mayors need to work together collectively in some way to kind of bargain with central government? Do we need a kind of cabinet of the mayors? So those are some of the questions that we're going to be exploring. But first of all, to introduce our panel, first up, Tom Walker is going to start speaking from the director. He's the director of the Cities and Local Growth Unit, which is a joint unit from the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy and Communities and Local Government. Tom leads work to boost local growth in England by devolving powers and budgets, and he's worked on both devolution deals and growth deals as part of his 18 years in the civil service. Next up, I'm going to ask Martin to speak. Martin is Chief Executive of Coventry City Council. He's previously worked at Bedfordshire County Council as Chief Executive and is former President of the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives, and now leads Solace's Digital Leadership Network. Next, Dave is going to speak. Dave Smith, Managing Director for the Sheffield City Region team. And Dave became Interim Managing Director in February last year and is responsible for the executive functions of the Combined Authority and the LEP, the Local Enterprise Partnership. And last but very much not least is John Rothmull, Head of Strategy at New Economy Manchester, which is shortly to become part of the Greater Manchester Combined Authority. And John's previous roles include Head of Economic Policy at the Labour Party and Economic Advisor at the Treasury. And John has very kindly stepped into this event to replace Rachel Pikett, to which we are very grateful. So thank you very much, John. So I'm going to ask each of our panellists to speak for 5 minutes, and I'm going to be ruthless with time, and we'll cut you off if necessary to enable plenty of time for questions and answers from the floor. So I'm going to start with Tom, who's going to give us an overview of, well, what are these mayors and what powers they're going to have?
So I'll be very brief, and thank you, Joe, for organising the event, and to Grant Thornton for doing this. This is one of many, many events that are starting to bubble up now, as the elections are just 6.5 weeks away. I've got some slides which I'll go through very, very quickly, but they are just to give you, if you're sort of new to this topic, some very basic facts and figures. So, if they go in the right direction, the first slide, which I hope shows in the glare of the spotlights, this is just what have we actually done. The key things in here, I think, are the number of voters going to the polls, so 6.7 million people overall. They obviously vary in size, and there's clearly a bigger population other than eligible voters. But this is the scale of the change that we're talking about. And if you add in London, it means that in effect a third of the English population live or will live under the leadership of a directly elected mayor. I've also included Cornwall in this slide. That had a devolution deal but not a mayoral deal. Sometimes it's part of the story, sometimes not, but I think it's important that devolution hasn't just been to our city regions. And obviously Dave is here from Sheffield, who doesn't have an election this May, but have been part of the journey in developing devolution deals and devolved policy. So those are just some very basic facts. I don't want to read through this at all, but just again, if you're coming new to this, why does this matter? Well, these are the sorts of powers that mayors will have at their disposal. They'll work in partnership with their combined authority, of course, but includes fiscal powers, housing and planning powers, significant transport powers and budgets, skills and labour market innovations, including the delegation of the adult skills budget, and in some places, most notably Manchester, becoming the police and crime commissioner as well, and taking on, as it says, fire and rescue powers. So these are really broad-ranging powers, and there are significant budgets in there, including additional funding. But I absolutely agree with everything Joe said about those five reasons, the sort of leadership, the soft power, the convening power that mayors will bring. The next six slides are a bit boring, but they're essentially six of the same. There's one for every city in the interest of balance. And I think also exciting you. Now, the key thing is to look at the pictures, because all I did is, this is our media campaign. And if you're here from an organisation who's interested in sort of promoting turnout and raising awareness, we have a whole heap of material that we can share. But they're just some visual aids to sort of hammer home the point. These are significant elections. Elections are always best when the turnout is highest, and I guess some of you will live in our northern cities, but maybe more of you live in Cambridge and Peterborough. So these are a selection, this is like my holiday slideshow, of visuals. Manchester, we deliberately chose this Thameside picture, you know, to illustrate the point. This isn't just the inner city urban regeneration that sometimes gets showed, it is the entire conurbation of Greater Manchester, and the map in the bottom right hand corner shows that. Merseyside, Tees Valley, obviously a huge part of our industrial strategy. And then, because Martin is here, Coventry Cathedral, one of the most beautiful buildings in the country, where you're hosting a mayoral debate tomorrow, Wednesday. So in other words, this debate is sort of coming live. And it, as I say, if you're interested in promoting awareness, turnout, public information, we have material you can share. I shouldn't, of course, forget the West of England and Bristol. What's next? I mean, I'm not going to debate now, but will through the session, the sort of how is Whitehall changing, what are we doing? We'll pick that up through the conversations. But these are my requests for you. One, that you help raise awareness of these important elections. If you're from an organisation that wants to work with mayors, how are you going to support and collaborate with them? These are collaborative partnerships. And wherever you work, whether you're a Whitehall department or someone else, you know, you too are going to have to sort of think about these powerful new figures who we think will have considerable sway. So those are my top line messages, and just to give everyone a common starting point, really, in that basic information.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, Tom. Martin.
Thanks, Joe. Good to see everybody. Thanks to Grant Thornton and the Institute for putting this on. Much needed. Another opportunity for Tom and I to do a double act. Batman and Robin again, decide who's who. 2 minutes on the Westminster Combined Authority, because that's the reason that I think I'm here, as well as obviously my Coventry City Council hat, and then just a minute each on some points which I think should stimulate the debate later. First of all, those that aren't aware, the Westminster Combined Authority, yes, electorate just shy of 2 million, but actually the combined authority covers a geography well in excess of 4.2 million. And the very point of the slideshow, really importantly, the three proud cities of Wolverhampton, Coventry and Birmingham, but also a significant wealth of assets around that in terms of our county and district areas, both rural and urban. So for those that haven't seen, we have an absolute determination to double our output over 15 years, cross the national productivity line by 2026, and create over 500,000 net new jobs. Now, this is game changing, and you know, I had the hat on last week over at MIPIM, the Property Expo, as part of Midlands UK. The centre of this country, quite rightly, is pivoting on an axis, is starting to change, and I think that's great. So that's a bit about us. But in terms of maybe a minute around some of the issues, and I'm not surprised, we've already heard the word power mentioned probably half a dozen times. Look, if you look at those six areas, the powers vested in the mayor are in many ways generic in some areas, very specific in others. If the discussion about the efficacy of a metro mayor and a direct elected mayor from the 4th of May onwards is about those powers which are in statutory terms vested in them, then you've missed the whole point. This is about, and convening has been mentioned already, this is about a new set of behaviours for place leadership, both within a region of scale, but also between the regions, and I'll come back to that in my third point, and central government. And the ability to stand on platforms and talk about things in a fundamentally different way to that which was able to be done before, and be listened to, even if the levers aren't the hard ones. And I think we'll keep coming back to that, but I think that's my first point. The second point is around the notion of individually this will be different. Of course it will. You've seen some of the personalities that are emerging already for the mayoral elections. They'll be different in different parts of the country. But individually, there'll be history. Greater Manchester is fundamentally different in its maturity model, for example, than my own in the West Midlands, where no one would give us a chance 2 years ago for the political leaders of the seven Mets to have got themselves together, convened themselves across that large area, and got ourselves ready for an incredibly large-scale opportunity. So that would be different according to how the new mayor works with those existing leaders, and that shouldn't be forgotten, because there's almost a shell-shock understanding of the existing leaders who are responsible for significant units of organisation in a their own right. I would also say they've got their own mandate to advocate for their place, both nationally and internationally. So individually we're going to see differences, and I think that's worth watching. The third bit though is around, for me, the collective stuff. And looking at that slide, whichever way, one of Tom's first slides, whichever way you want to do it, either cut it by electorate, and that is an issue about engagement, and we'll come back to that, by electorate volume. If you then look about geographical coverage, or probably what I prefer to do, look at economic vitality and potential, those six mayors on the day after the election, when we all wake up, will represent a significantly high percentage of our gross domestic product, split across very many different types of sectors, which are potent both nationally and internationally. Now, the reason I say that is there's then an issue about, is a cabinet convened to be able to understand the power of that? My view, it will naturally happen. In fact, it's happening already in terms of, and I always talked about this notion of a kind of reservoir dog's carpet image of some really powerful mayors that come together, potentially different colour administrations, very different individuals that are collectively going to be lobbying on behalf of their places, but across the whole area, to talk to government about a fundamentally different way of reimagining UK PLC and how our city regions can continue to have the renaissance they're having in a post-Brexit, necessarily international world with different trade arrangements. So my final point, I'll shut up. There's something then about the collective, and then I suppose there's a 3A bit around that, is the notion of changing behaviours and how this will either sustain itself, which I think was Joe's point, or find itself vulnerable. Remember that the reason that combined authorities come into play is not just about economic growth and prosperity, using the powers of transport, housing, and those levers that we would understand to be classic levers of economic potency. But they're also about how the other side of the coin, you can literally reform and reimagine again public services at scale. Now, at the moment, the reformation of public services at scale and improving better lives for people, I'm afraid, is the less shiny side of the coin. So the question I would pose to this audience for us to debate is, as this all plays out in changing behaviours at scale, how do we ensure that to make it sustainable, the right narrative, the right conversations are happening, whereby on a campaigning level, if you see mayors going right at the heart of public service reform, which some of us would say they should be naturally talking about, that falls right into the, if you like, the sweet spot of the metropolitan leaders and the leaders of councils who are charged, in their view, with delivering reform public services. So I haven't got the answers, but I think we would expect our mayors to understand that breadth and not just get on a wide-body jet to the other side of the world and sail the region, as important as that is, but also understand this is about inclusive growth and about understanding the kind of growth we are creating under mayoral combined authorities for the future.
That's really interesting, and something we've done some work on at the Institute on kind of public service reform and whether mayors can actually help bring people together to integrate public services more effectively locally. So Dave, can we hear about your experience in Sheffield?
Yes, I think that it's a story of two sides of a coin, really, in Sheffield. At the heart of the drive to deliver a mayoral combined authority is the absolute belief that ultimately the people who make the most difference to driving economic growth, prosperity and improved productivity are the people who live, work and function within the region. And that, beyond anything else, remains the core driver that keeps the politicians and business leaders in the region together working to deliver change in the Sheffield City region. And to that extent, that drive and that unerring belief in delivering that agenda has meant the business that we have been doing, which is not often the part that's reported, is making a difference. For the first time in more than a generation, Sheffield City Region has recently seen net jobs growth. First time in a generation. We've now got a position where we're leading in innovation and research in advanced manufacturing to the extent of successfully attracting McLaren and their next generation of cars to move from Europe to build in the Sheffield City region because of the relationship with innovation, research and design. That sort of game-changing moves happens because the people who are making the decisions are local, they understand the agenda, they understand the opportunity and they understand the challenges. But it's a hugely complex issue for us because the other side of that same coin is that because the Sheffield City region absolutely is focused on the economy and is not currently involved in wider issues of public service reform, it wants to deliver a Sheffield City Region mayoral combined authority that represents the actual economic functioning area. And as you'll all understand, functioning economic areas do not respect administrative boundaries. So because Chesterfield, which is in North Derbyshire, and Bassetlaw, which is an urban area in North Nottinghamshire, are intrinsically linked with Sheffield and Doncaster in particular, in terms of the economic activity, they want to be, and we want them to be, part of our mayoral combined authority. But that's led us into complex, difficult and very challenging relationships with some of our political neighbours who see this as a huge challenge to their own political administrative boundaries. And that's meant that's come at a cost, that challenge. So we can't go with an election this May. And we're continuing to work our way through those challenges. And the leaders and government have committed to a mayoral election in May next year, in the hope that we'll have resolved these other challenges so that we can deliver out on what we think are the best opportunities for the Sheffield City region. For us, you see, both in terms of the decision makers, both from the private sector as well as the public sector, them stepping up to the issues of change within the way that they think, behave and act and react to the opportunities and challenges within their region. And you begin to understand that this is more than just governance change, it's more than just improving the economy. it's actually taking charge and being responsible and accountable for the commitments that you make to the region and its people. We hope, and it's our continuing relationship with government as we develop, that government will recognise and also increasingly respect that relationship and that ability to take responsibility, and in government's terms, continue to cede power and ability to make those decisions to local leaders and ultimately, in our case, the mayor, so that we're able not just to say we want the responsibility, but we're treated as grown-ups capable of making decisions on reasoned and rational basis in the best interests of our community. And that's the sort of grown-up, mature partnership that we're seeking to achieve internally within the region and between the region and government.
Great, thank you very much. And the perspective from Greater Manchester.
Yes, well, first of all, thank you again for the for hosting today, and it's particularly useful to be able to hear about the insights and experiences of other places as well going through the same process as we are in Greater Manchester. I'll just spend a couple of minutes on how some of the government structures within Greater Manchester are going to be changing ahead of the mayoral election on the 4th of May, and then come on to what that might mean for implications for how the relationship with Whitehall stays the same or changes. Hopefully some things will stay the same within Greater Manchester, one of which is a long history of collaboration and working together and strong governance structures, which will hopefully stand us in good stead. And secondly, I think a level of ambition shown not least through the delegation of health and social care powers that'll hopefully put us in a good position. But there is quite a lot of governance change going on at the moment, not least at New Economy, where I'm based at the moment, which will be coming with the combined authority on the 1st of April. And the structure of the new combined authority is going to reflect, as you expect, the powers that have been that are going to be delivered by the authority. And it's just worth saying that the powers of the mayor are different from the powers of the combined authority, and we're talking here about a different model from London. For example, the individual leaders of the districts in Greater Manchester will form the mayor's cabinet. There are some decisions which can only be taken on a unanimous basis across all of those, across the mayor and all of the 10 leaders. So it is going to be a different model, and there are going to be, I'm sure, relationships to be developed and issues to be worked through. As a sort of very general split, the mayor's powers are, or formal powers, come on to something relating to that in a moment, the mayor's formal powers are across housing and planning, transport and police and crime commissioner and fire and rescue services. The combined authority, skills, business support, which was devolved, although the budgets were then cut, expansion of working well in the work and health programme, and also, as I mentioned, playing a big role in the delegation of health and social care. So there are various different parts of the Greater Manchester family which has been fulfilling all these different functions coming together within the combined authority. New Economy, which has provided the sort of the analytical and policy development basis for the devolution journey we've been on. There's a public service reform function. There's the Greater Manchester Integrated Support Team, which provides a lot of the practical support. Office of Police and Crime Commissioner, Waste Services will be coming in, and co-location with parts of the health policy team. Some of you may have noticed that in that list was not Transport for Greater Manchester, but there's already a close relationship between the combined authority and TFGM, both in governance terms and working terms, and I'm sure that'll continue to develop and get even closer. But what's going to change coming out of that functional reform, and what some of those implications are? Well, another thing worth mentioning is we've got the retirement of Sir Howard Bernstein as Chief Exec at Manchester City Council in a couple of weeks' time. He's going to be replaced by a Chief Executive at the City Council, but also a separate Chief Executive at the Combined Authority. Those two roles are going to be separated. And I think that points towards perhaps a more formalised structure than there's been in the past, and the combined authority looking like something more like we'd recognise as a central government department. And there's also, with a single political figure in the mayor with a direct electoral mandate, I think he or she, probably he, is going to have a much higher profile and look to as a spokesperson on behalf of the city region. And in terms of the lessons from London, Joe and others have mentioned the soft power already. I think you only need to look at the manifestos of the mayoral candidates in Greater Manchester and then compare that against the formal powers and the devolution deals to realise that the ambitions of the candidates go much wider than their formal powers. So there's a lot there to be. How we're able to develop that soft power role is going to be crucial. It also raises questions, I think, about the future of the Northern powerhouse and how that developed and how relationships there developed, which I won't dwell on now, but we can perhaps come on to in more detail in the discussion. And then finally, how the relationship with Whitehall might then change. The truth is, it feels as though it has already changed as the some of the key personalities, the Chancellor's changed, some of the key Treasury officials, obviously Sir Howard retiring. But in some ways, the formalisation within the new combined authority might make it easier for Whitehall to engage, or at least know where and how to engage with the Greater Manchester structure. I think the politicisation, there will be some politicisation in that the new mayor is likely to want a higher profile, and some discussions which would in the past have been in private might be carried out in public. And I think finally it also feels as the dynamic of devolution is changing at the moment. The impetus towards devolution as an end in itself feels as though it is running out. Just by way of an example, compare the budget in 2016 with the budget in 2017. And I did a quick scan, and in 2016 there were 13 pages on English devolution, and the word devolution appeared 44 times in the text. In budget 2017 there was one paragraph and the word devolution came up twice. So that gives you an idea of just a sense of how government priorities are shifting. But I think then the challenge for us as combined authorities is going to be, well, how do we push our agenda in different ways? For example, the industrial strategy is going to sit at the heart of a lot of what we're trying to do, and I don't think we'll be able to develop the policies or deliver the policies of the industrial strategy without a significant role for the combined authority. So the focus on devolution is changing, but that doesn't mean, I don't think, that there's not still going to be a crucial role for that combined authority Whitehall relationship.
Great, thank you very much. So lots of issues raised there, and I just want to pick up a few of those before we open it up to all of you to ask questions. Martin, can I come to you first? Because you've recently called for a kind of sector-wide debate on the future of local government. So do you think that the new sets of mayors that are coming in are going to provide the kind of strong leadership to have that kind of debate with central government?
So the discussion that hasn't been had that needs to be had is not just about the sector-wide issues on local government. It's actually, my point was, we need to understand some fundamental, profound questions about what is the state all about in this changing world, including devolution. But yeah, specifically my own sector, what is local government going to be able to do in the future with a very different narrative with the people that we serve? Now, of course, that immediately then brings you back to a lot of the things that have been brought up already, which is, how can you create the headroom, financially, fiscally, within city regions at scale, to then be able to not just deal with the kind of skills challenges, productivity challenges for the future, but also give us the headroom to reform public services and to transform them properly, rather than just kind of a piecemeal sticky plaster, was kind of my point. So I guess the question for this is, my point about public service reform and economic growth and the role of mayors, how does all that play out in a way which is, I think people have talked about, a mature conversation, which is less about territory and about discipline, about control and power, but more about, if you create the conditions for growth in my neck of the woods in the West Midlands and don't take people with you, then actually you're going to end up with a really poor, lack of sustainability kind of growth for the future. So yeah, absolutely we should have this debate. It's really, really difficult. The issue about devolution, whether it's in play or not, well, we're certainly determined in the West Midlands, I'm sure Greater Manchester and others are, is to make sure we use these set of opportunities now to probably reform and reframe the conversations between places and government. I've talked about, to Tom about this a lot. I think these are tough because they're not about value judgments, about where the top policy thinking is or where power sits. They're actually about, there are some challenges facing this country at the moment, which some could say are virtually intractable. Others would say are a perfect opportunity for us to think very differently about the relationship between the state, the people that we serve, and the power of wealth creation in generating a very different kind of outcomes for the future where our people are at the heart of it. But that's really difficult conversations. It's much easier just to have kind of these high-level platitudes about central-local relationships. Is devolution in play or not? Well, with or without devolution, we'd be having to have these conversations about a precipice that public services are coming off in terms of their funding potential, with raising expectations and people still feeling like they're in this pinball machine of collateral damage and trying to make sense of how this is going to play out for them across our city regions.
And Tom, how do you think the rest of Whitehall is going to need to adapt? So having been at the centre of the negotiations between the combined authorities and Whitehall, yeah. But perhaps some departments have been less involved, powers that haven't yet been devolved. So what's going to be different about working in Whitehall as a civil servant after the mayors are elected?
So the point's already been made that I think some of the big shift has come already in doing devolution deals and the nature of the relationship, certainly between these six places and Whitehall, layered on with an industrial strategy which puts place at the heart of industrial policy in a way that certainly wasn't, I don't think, in the recent past there, and a housing white paper which equally, I think, steps away from some centralised programmes towards a more dialogue-based approach about how you deliver activity on the ground. And both of those two things, job creation and economic growth and housing, absolutely fit with Martin's description of some pretty difficult challenges. They're not the only ones, and clearly public service reform has a whole heap of others. So the myth that I think is not helpful for anyone to sort of sustain is that somehow there is a hermetically sealed Whitehall refusing to engage and sort of places knocking on the door. That just isn't the reality. Do places say they like more power, less control, less monitoring and everything else? Well, of course they do, and that tension is there. But I think we're in a space where there is a pretty mature dialogue about that. Of course, departments then have more or less centralised approaches to reforms, but actually if you look at some of the more radical things in the welfare space, they're actually happening through these deals, building on some reforms in city deals, so you can't paint DWP as a sort of naysayer. Other departments do have centralised reforms, but we see on adult skills budget, for example, a significant shift in the approach. So what are the magic ingredients here? Well, some of what the mayors will deliver, leadership, convening power, the ability to sort of broker relationships. And then I think for Whitehall, the task is always to be in listening mode, and for places is to kind of get out of an adversarial relationship and into one which is about solving problems, which I think in the end is what, if you strip away the word devolution and put the emphasis on the word deal, is what we've achieved already. So I don't think there's going to be some sweeping shift. There will be a growing maturity of relationships with these places and with others.
Great, thank you. And can I come to you to ask how you think the kind of mayors should work together as a group in kind of engaging with Whitehall and indeed with national politicians?
I think, as we've already said, there are common agendas across all the major combined authorities. Some differences, clearly, but some things of which we have a common cause. And it's clearly we're stronger working together, as the Northern Powerhouse has already proved, than we are just simply working in isolation. And in that context, I think it's incredibly important. I think particularly for me on the agendas of rebalancing the economy, of ensuring that the right investment goes into the Midlands and the North of England to provide the best opportunities for growth. There is a great deal in which the combined authorities and mayors can cooperate on making those arguments tangible and real with the backing of obviously of their mandate. And I think that's incredibly important going forward if we're to build on a system that that collaborates as well as at obvious points in the process competes. And seeing the opportunity to collaborate, I think, is incredibly important within this new system.
Great, thank you. And John, just picking up on a point that we've made here at the Institute before around open data, I was at a meeting last week about kind of preparing for mayors where the issue of data came up, and what kind of data are the new mayors going to need to have, and indeed do they have access to it? So is data the kind of area that you think that mayors should get together and kind of lobby central government for more access to what they need to run their areas effectively?
I think that's definitely part of it. Interesting points which came out of the RSA's Inclusive Growth Commission recently was the paucity of data, particularly on regional growth and actually in social as well as economic policy. At the moment, it's very difficult often to make timely and informed decisions about things because data the data that's collected at a national level takes such a long time to arrive and is not necessarily at the levels that you need it. But there's also data being generated from elsewhere within the local government system and from within cities. And so in Greater Manchester, GM Connect has been set up, which is trying to harvest that data and bring it together and use it in different ways across the combined authority. So there's a discussion there to be had with national government and the ONS. But there are also opportunities that to use the data that's there already in better ways.
Great. So again, something that mayors can perhaps learn and work together on, kind of learning from models that are being applied in different areas. I'm going to open it up to the floor. Please can you wait for the microphone and say your name and organisation, and if you are sitting in the room next door, please do come in if you'd like to ask a question. And can I ask you to keep your comments and questions brief, and bear in mind that panellists aren't going to be able to comment on candidates in the elections, for example. So can I start over here, please, with David in the corner, for those with a roving mic. And I'm going to take questions in groups of three, and so the next one here, please.
David Walker, Guardian Public. There's a pretty obvious syllogism between schools and educational attainment and productivity growth. Could you say something about the non-relationship between the devolution chapter we're going to unfold and schools policy, specifically the lack of co-terminosity even between regional schools commissioners and the new regions, except in the case of the West Midlands, which is the only one where there is at least common boundaries?
And the second question was just here. If we can get a mic to here, please. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you. Vernon Boggs, North King's College, London. Two brief questions. Firstly, what are the arrangements for scrutinising the mayors? I gather there's not going to be a directly elected assembly as there is in London. So how's the mayor to be scrutinised between elections? And secondly, what are the limits on devolution? I mean, we all think of it as part of our social union, part of the welfare state, that the benefits you get depend not on where you live, but on your basic needs. This is a fundamental principle. Does this process of devolution, which we've had, following on devolution to Scotland, Northern Ireland and Wales, I mean, ideally you need a constitution laying out what is suitable for devolution and what isn't, but should we now have, prepared by central government, a charter laying out the principles on which particular functions may or may not be devolved?
Thank you. And the third question was just here.
Nick Sharman, a refugee from the regional development movement of hallowed memory. A couple of points, though, that I think we need to learn from that. First of all, the gap between the ambitions that everyone has set out around the economy and the tools that you have to put that into place seems so wide that my worry is that there'll be some local disillusion and some worries from Whitehall, because we can't deliver all the promises. So that gap seems to me a very real one. And the two points that regional development agencies had was, first, sufficient funds, way outside the amount that's available to the LEPs and certainly to that to make an effective body. The other thing they had was area, that the areas they covered were genuine travel to work and economic areas, whereas these seem a spatch you know, and very a mixture. Some, like West Midlands, have got a reasonable spread, others haven't at all. Can I finally just say something about accountability? I'm a local councillor in Hackney, where the gap between the mayor and the people is a real one around accountability. And I want to ask whether people think that some version of a public accounts committee locally is perhaps the answer to make the bridge between people and the new authorities.
Thank you. So some really interesting issues there around scrutiny and accountability, schools and public services, whether there should be limits to devolution, different approaches to devolution that outlined there, very different from the kind of deal-based approach. Tom, can I come to you first?
Thank you. I'm a Hackney resident, by the way, so I don't know if you represent my ward, but I've never met you, just to show the accountability gap. Where can I start on these? I mean, the schools one I'll leave to others, I think, other than to say that if you look at the manifestos that have been published, and we've seen Andy Burnham's, Andy Street's, and this morning Sean Anstey's, these three candidates at least, and I think it will be the same for other, are not restrained by the powers that I listed up on the screen. And I think education, schools, driving levels of attainment will be a key debate for mayors as they're elected. So that's what I want to say on that. I mean, on scrutiny, so we have put in place much strengthened overview and scrutiny relationships through the passage of the bill and in Parliament, which the House of Lords recognised. I mean, clearly that needs to be resourced and stood up to function in as an effective way as possible. But there are formal overview and scrutiny powers with some important restrictions about the chair of the overview and scrutiny arrangement not being from the same political party as the mayor, for example. So we think we've made some significant improvements there. And then touched on in the question, which I'm not going to do in massive depth, but it is really important to understand that these mayors are very different from the London mayor and indeed from sort of traditional council mayor. I don't mean traditional ceremonial, but the sort of mayor Jules Pipe was, or Joe Anderson is in Liverpool, for example. And so some of the scrutiny comes from the combined authority relationship and the checks and balances on the mayor within that arrangement. And maybe Dave and Martin might want to say something about that. The RDAs is a really interesting question, because I think for everyone that says they provided the scale, and we'll separate questions of budget and scale, a sort of agglomerated level compared to what we have now. I think there are plenty of others that say the regional footprint was just too big, didn't resonate either as identity or indeed as functional economic areas. And so what we've introduced here seeks to find that balance, largely based on the LEP geography. I mean, I think funds in local growth, that's a whole different debate, you know, fiscal constraints and everything else. But the key ingredients are an economic strategy which really prioritises the key drivers of growth in any geography, and then prioritises the investment, whatever the scale of available resource. And I think that maturity comes through our arrangements. So that would be my offer. There were more than three questions in there, definitely. But Martin,
do you want to pick up on the schools point, perhaps, and others?
I think the answer is in the question. You know, ask the question, and Dave and other colleagues will have to do likewise when they're posed the question, what's the biggest risk to, I'll pick up the delivery issue as well, to these combined authorities and delivering the kind of vitality for the future. And often the reflex is, in my case, people say, well, an £8 billion infrastructure programme, trying to understand how we can create the right capability and capacity to deliver when HS2 is flying all over the place and creating an understandable drain on resource. That's the biggest risk. Without any doubt, my answer is the biggest risk is the complete lack of coherence we still have about skills and productivity in this country. And actually, and it's a phrase I know I use too much, it is an ecosystem. Unless you go after everything from early years and preparing our youngsters beyond what we would say are the parameters of school readiness, the social stuff is powerful. I mean, about what their future might be, empowering them all the way through, including the challenge of a national curriculum, which I believe is palpably not where it needs to be for kind of the future internationalisation that we face and so on. With our 50-year-olds that we know very well in the West Midlands are outside the job market because of our industrial past and require just some recalibration confidence back into the market for another 10, 15 years productive life. Now, I know that's big. I know it's difficult, but unless we through devolution start working with government, not at them, or some kind of begging bowl for give us all the money, give us all devolved powers, therefore we'll fix it, then I think we're going to have real, real problems. So that's the thing on schools and the whole skills agenda. This is an opportunity to try and be much more coherent than ever before, and there is no magic bullet to this. I think we're, as leaders, we're missing the point if we think there is. The capability and capacity issue I kind of refer to, I think that's important as well around, you know, again, others will make their own views, and GM's been around a lot longer, so they would have built their own mature structures. There's a balance here. So you've got the Westminster Combined Authority as an organisation. As I sit here as its chief executive, as we approach 6 weeks from mayor election, we've got roughly 400 colleagues working in that body. And all of those, with the exception probably of a handful, came from a transport body. My sense is you need to balance the ability to have the right people in our structures to deliver the kind of programmes of change we're talking about, but not to create, I think, the challenge we had in the past, which is superstructures that have become self-serving. Because if you think about it, what will happen, arguably unintentionally, is you recreate this disconnection that's happened at a Brussels, Strasbourg level through Whitehall into just happens to be Birmingham, Coventry, Wolverhampton, the West Midlands, with a sense of remoteness, which comes to the Hackney point, away from actually how people live their lives. But we've also got to get real. Here's an £8 billion infrastructure programme. So I'm going to be on one now, but this is really important. So to deliver that, we are completely revenue poor. So we're now pulling into a situation whereby in order to deliver, first year of a mayoral budget, because they can't precept until year two, that's fine. We go into the revenue game, which is used to gear up our capital infrastructure for the future. You say, well, get on with it, Martin, that's what you have to do. Are we really being serious that there is virtually no revenue to be able to deliver the kind of space we need for policy thinking for the future? So I think it needs, again, a mature conversation. It's not a kind of crass, Tom, give us millions and millions and we'll be fine, to create whole back offices. It's about, we're only going to do this once. I know Tom's heard me say this and others. We're going to do this once and we've got to do it well. We're going to reimagine our entire cities and places at scale. So I think just some more sensible recalibration of revenue might be helpful.
Great, thank you. And John and Dave, what about this issue of the gap between the kind of issues that the public care about? So we know that health is one, when the mayoral areas have been polled, that people want health sorting out, but only Greater Manchester has sort of significant powers over health, and the actual powers that mayors are going to have in the first instance. John, do you want to start?
Well, I suppose, as you say, we've perhaps a bit of an advantage in Greater Manchester because there are already powers over health and social care. And I think that there might be an interesting insight in there into perhaps ways of changing the education skills debate as well, because I agree with everything that Martin was saying about education skills and the fragmentation of the system. But the health and social care devolution deal with Greater Manchester came from within the system. It was people within the system wanting to find different ways of working and collaborating and then putting forward a proposal. I wonder if what we might start to see are similar things happening within the education skills system at the moment, because at the moment there's no sign of any sort of top-down willingness to engage with further devolution or further powers. So I wonder if it might have to happen from bottom up. But just coming back to the point about public engagement, I think it's interesting that the mayoral candidates in Greater Manchester are, in their manifestos, already exploring different ways of engaging with the public, whether it's around question times, whether it's around reaching out to other groups of people who aren't usually involved in the political debate to get their input into the process. And so clearly they're aware of the risk of the disconnect, and part of their role politically is going to be to try and fix that.
And we've seen, I think, some really interesting examples internationally as well about how mayors can kind of engage with the electorates, and Bloomberg Philanthropies have done lots of work working with mayors in America and beyond that have looked at different ways of kind of getting citizens really involved in day-to-day decision-making in government. So it feels like there are a lot of opportunities for us to take some of that learning from other countries and bring that into the UK. But Dave?
I absolutely agree with that. And I would also add that we should not, we forget at our peril the highest level of public engagement we've had for a long time was in the referendum. And that wasn't about health, but it was everything to do with about people's discontent with their place in society, their ability to feel included, to feel that they could be active participants in their own communities and so on. And of course, the nature of that debate is an incredibly local as well as national one. And it, and any mayor, particularly in the urban areas, that ignores that agenda, I would say, ignores it at their peril. And for me, its expression is more than just one single policy, whether it's health or skills. Or it's about how people are experiencing their life and their life chances. And for too long, governance, both national and local, has siloed policy, has treated people as though we fit into neat boxes or pieces of policy. And if we don't fit neatly in, well, we're sort of, we fall out the other end. And too many people in our communities experience life like that. And unless we begin to understand that agenda and work with it, both politically and managerially, in terms of how we deliver public services in a different way, then we'll continue to get the sort of reaction and levels of public engagement, but in a way that perhaps makes us fearful for the future rather than embraces the future.
Can I take some more questions? There's this lady here, just in the middle, please. Just here. Thank you.
Hi, Julia Goldsworthy, PwC. There's been a bit of discussion from the panel on the capacity limitations of combined authorities, particularly new ones, but what about Whitehall, when there's this massive task of working out what Brexit's going to mean? So is there the capacity on the other side to continue that mature discussion? And how is the definition of success going to change? Just because it feels at the moment that a lot of the focus is around deal size, kind of quite hard economic measures, and actually just around the elections themselves and the fact that they're going to happen. So how are we going to define success beyond turnout on May the 4th?
Great, thank you. And then there was a question just here.
Thank you. Sam Thomas from Making Every Adult Matter Coalition. It's clear from everything that the panel have said, and certainly from the work I've done with colleagues in the West Midlands, that there's already been a lot of work done in these areas on public service reform. There's been a lot of effort by officials and in working with government as well. Clearly the mayors provide an opportunity to put some political pressure behind that work, but equally not all of them have been involved in that work up to that point and may have different views about the way that should play out. So I suppose my question is, how much are you expecting there to be continuity with that work, and how much actually is this going to be about a new set of agendas and potentially revisiting some of the decisions that have already been taken?
Great, thank you. And then there's a question here in the front. Thanks.
Hi, Henry Kippen from Collaborate. Question to Dave and to Martin in particular. What does all of this mean over the medium term for the role of the local authority chief exec?
Very good question. Okay, so I'm going to start with that one and come to you, Dave, first of all.
Thanks. I don't think it's
a microphone working.
Yeah, absolutely. This is the rehearse, but no. I simply don't see this as a binary issue. I think, as Martin said earlier, the biggest risk I see from a mayoral combined authority, or even just from a combined authority, is it's somehow seen as the challenge to local authorities. And as if one needs to be powerful, and the only way to be powerful is the other to become disempowered. And I just simply don't see the world like that. I think in terms of defining, and it comes back to an earlier question about whether we need a constitutional settlement around these things. I don't know whether we need it that formalised, maybe we do. But the essence of the question, I think, is absolutely right. That if you deal with different geographies with different challenges, then some rationality needs to come into what's relevant and pertinent to make the most difference to people's lives at what level of geographic spatial level and political power level and decision making. And I absolutely believe that to be the case. And the success for this is in the maturing of relationships. And I think the key risk for all this is that those of us who are in combined authorities that essentially have been formed in the last few years are racing to develop our maturity and partnership in the attain the level that Manchester have attained, when Manchester have been doing this under various headings for 20 years. And unless we understand that you can't force the pace of change and development in that sort of binary way, then we will end up having a scrap about who's got power and who hasn't, rather than how do we best serve the interests of our communities.
Martin, do you want to pick up on that?
I think that's a very good question, Henry, which is why I've been jealously guarding the two jobs for the last year, just to work out. That is a joke, by the way, Jane and others. That is a joke. Maybe the way to answer it is to reframe the question slightly, which is, what is the legitimacy, power, relevance, currency of local authorities of places, including big places, in this future devolved world of larger structures and everything else? And this is my honest view. The way this will work out, I think it's two timings. Over the next term of a mayor, I think in terms of people like me, senior colleagues, I think there is a job of work to do to understand the layers that are happening, the power of place in places like Coventry, Burnham, Wolverhampton, the rural areas, the county areas, but also how we can drive reform of services, reduce cost, and hopefully lever the massive economic uplift that we all need for our places. We've talked about jobs, housing, everything else. And I think that's a massive job of work. But because I'm honest and I'm candid, does that then remain the status quo for the next mayoral election, the one after? I think there's some really important debates about not the efficacy of local authorities. I think there'll always be the absolute passion, which is why I came into local government, to drive that legitimacy of local place and understand and amplify its world for its people in whatever structures are above it or through it. But I think in terms of the high cost of organisations, including the most expensive cost, which is local authority chief execs, I think if we're going to be candid in this new world, you need to have a conversation over the medium to long term about what that means. And what it means in terms of, if you're moving to a devolved settlement whereby there is accountability, and we'll talk about probably fiscal devolution and tools for the trade later, but for an individual who can convene that kind of power alongside a cabinet, well, surely you should be having similar conversations, if not with the same answers, about the power of senior officers and the cost to serve across such a big area. And I think that's legitimate. And I'm not clever enough to work out all those answers, and it'll be different. But I think to not have that discussion over time, I think is reinforcing some of the problems we've had in the past about organisations that aren't confident enough in their own skin, or indeed a profession, to be able to talk about these things. And maybe I'm outspoken, but I spend most of my time with Westminster colleagues saying we must understand our own leadership role in this changing, but not just to default to, I've got a big organisation to run on behalf of the politicians, but how we can work as place leaders on a bigger scale but not get in the way. When we've got all the challenges we've already said about cost to serve is really, really important to understand, because as austerity continues to bite, we cannot duplicate, we cannot create individual superstructures around any particular profession. And my own personal view, which is not joined by everybody, but there are very few, if any, services in terms of the way in which they're thought of and delivered that can't be at least reimagined and reconvened at a larger scale. Doesn't mean to say there'll never be an amazing set of services delivered through a Coventry footprint or a Manchester or Trafford. That'll always be the case, but to actually think about that layering is something that people would rather avoid talking about.
Tom, does Whitehall have the capacity to do devolution given Brexit?
So I think it does, for a number of reasons, but you've just published a report, haven't you, on capacity in Whitehall.
We have,
so
indeed.
You're in the wrong seminar. Go to next week's seminar. I mean, the thing that's worth saying, so in November 2014, that was when the Manchester devolution deal was done, and it caught a lot of people by surprise. It was developed very privately, and that is nearly 2.5 years ago. So we've been in a period, and of course Manchester haven't been sitting still, sort of debating governance and everything else, but overall we've been in a period of designing models, securing legislation, and taking a huge volume of secondary legislation through the House of Commons and the House of Lords to get the arrangements in place. And that's taken a long time. People said that we couldn't do it. We've just about done it. There are one or two orders left. I remember talking to Martin and his colleagues on the cusp, both before and after the election in 2015. If you'd said that West Midlands were going to form a combined authority with a directly elected mayor on the sort of time people said we couldn't do it, your politicians took some incredibly brave steps. So I think when the will is there, you make terrific progress. I don't really think it's an issue of capacity, and I think what will happen, and why this debate is both well timed, but sort of if we have it in 10 weeks time, it will be even more interesting when mayors come into office. That's when we're really going to see, you know, what's the dialogue with ministers, what's the relationship with Whitehall, are there any good ideas in the manifestos, do the local coalitions hold, etc, etc, etc. And I think you have to go into that optimistically. I mean, will there be bumps across the road? Of course there will. I'm not going to talk about the Brexit capacity issue. I mean, that's a sort of a macro topic all of its own. But if you look about what has been achieved and use that as your benchmark going forward, I think there's quite a lot of cause actually for optimism on this agenda. And that reflects also the maturity in places like Manchester, Sheffield and the West Midlands.
And John, what's your kind of definition of success in Greater Manchester beyond kind of turnout?
Success is going to, I think you can look at it at different levels. There'll be a very public political measure of success depending on whether the mayors get re-elected a second time round, and the public can come to that judgment. At a sort of delivery level, we're at the moment working on the details of putting together an outcomes framework, just thinking through refreshing the Greater Manchester strategy. What are the larger goals? How do they fit with central government's goals? But then what does that mean in terms of the things that need doing and the outcomes that you'd want, other measurable outcomes that you'd want to see whether that's been successful or not. But that's what's happening at a sort of a detailed delivery level. But there's also going to be a success question really for, I suppose, early in the next parliament about how embedded devolution or the current arrangements become and to what extent they continue. Because it does strike me a lot of the deals which have been done so far, and particularly a lot of the funding behind it, is time limited. I mean, if they're not renewed in the next spending review in the next parliament, a lot of this could just go back to central government almost by default. Now, whether that would be possible with new mayors in place, a whole different dialogue, a whole different set of relationships, I'm not. But I think that's the point at which success will ultimately be measured. Do the arrangements carry on before that point, or do we default back to something that looked more like 20 years ago?
Great, thank you. Can I take some more questions?
It's really important, not just because I made the point in the beginning and you've done some work in the West Midlands, but it is important. Because I think that just came across from the industrial strategy session earlier on, which was great, and some really important evidence-based stuff. But we've got to move from some of the abstract into the reality of what's going on this. So public service reform, it was about a decade ago that lots of conversations, actually, because of Andrew Donnelly's role here, around total place. Mm-hmm. So I think part of where we are now is, yes, there's been a lot of effort, and there's been a lot of initiatives. And up and down the country, some would say some are ahead of others, for integration, transformation, we started to build capacity around reforming services. I get that, but it's not good enough. It's not even patchy. It's appalling in the sense that we've not reimagined those services. And that we've all got to take responsibility for that scale across our places. So, in terms of reality, when the mayors get in, my point I was trying to make earlier, if you think about their platforming on right into the heart of, for example, configuration, reconfiguration issues of provider-sized stuff in health will be potentially difficult. However, if they use what I've seen from North American models and elsewhere, the power of platform to talk as only mayors can, more so than individual leaders or officers, to be able to talk about, for example, in the West Midlands, we've got a big campaign for West Midlands on the move, moving from sedentary lifestyles, not dissimilar to Greater Manchester stuff. That, for me, is a classic example of reality of what could be shifted, behaviour change shifting, platforms that are convening and talking at an entire scale, sometimes just the power of personality in that sense, and then the evidence backed up behind it. So I think what we need to do is accept the fact it's not been good enough, it's not been fast enough, it's not been deep enough, and we've got the time running out. But secondly, a good practical example under public sector reform, if you have those proper conversations and layer the responsibility at place level with a mayor, get the evidence in place, we could get the headroom to be able to go after some of the prevention agenda, wide-scale change in a way that maybe feels a little bit of jeopardy at the moment, and that only comes through sort of conversations.
Really helpful. So we had a question at the front here. There is one just behind there, and then one at the back. So just starting here, and then we'll come to you next. Thanks.
Thank you. John Hume. English local government's confusing enough as it is, and I just wondered, first of all, I'm still not convinced, why is there no equivalent of a Greater London Authority? Are we just simply talking of electing somebody once every 4 years or so? Two other quick points. What of the relationship between these new mayors and the existing metropolitan boroughs? Because I can't help feel in the public at large there'll be an enormous capacity of confusion as to who's responsible for what. And last but by no means least, the ugly subject of money, because local government has been the subject of very considerable cuts, and I just wonder to what extent will the city mayors be able to perhaps persuade other people to give them more money. Which, does this mean, you know, a preset from the council tax, or perhaps, dear one said, Whitehall being somewhat more generous than of late?
Great, thank you. And then the question just behind you.
Thank you. Peter Unwin from the Whitehall Industry Group. I want to come back to this point of scale and what is the right scale for these bodies. And if you take something like economic growth, if you look at the West Midlands, one of the biggest successes in recent years has been the renaissance of the car industry. But that stretches right from Staffordshire through the West Midlands, right down the M40 corridor to Oxford, and indeed way beyond the many of the supply chains. And if you look at other issues, skills, education, health, each of them has different sort of natural boundaries for which to look them at. So how are we going to stop all these new bodies having to spend all their time talking to other people across different boundaries about different issues and becoming a bureaucracy rather than doing things? Second, very quick question for Tom. For the two-thirds of England that would be living without a mayor after the 4th of May, should they be worried?
Thank you. And then there was one just towards the back there. Thank you.
Thank you. Tony Halmos from the Policy Institute, King's College, London. Two things, touching on some of the points that the panel have made. Firstly, should the process of devolving in this way, whether with combined authorities and mayors or what exactly the arrangement is, across the rest of England be moving much faster because of the problems in Whitehall that were referred to earlier? Namely, I think there is a capacity issue in Whitehall, indeed, as was said, this organisation has pointed it out. And secondly, there's a competence issue. I mean, a longer term issue than just the recent Brexit decision. Namely, the public service issues that are being talked about have not been run well for 40 years. Why is it not accepted that they can be run better at more local levels? And it's not said by government, of course not, they're being defensive, but it should be said more by the new authorities that they can run these things better and get on with it. And the other thing is money, as referred to, but a different angle on money. Are the areas the new authorities that are represented here today in particular happy with the money deal they've currently got? And if not, what are the problems? And in particular, not has Whitehall doled out enough money to them, but have they got enough power to raise their own money at their own discretion without being told by caps and other things that they can't do it?
Great, thank you. So lots of issues there around the kind of confusion of English local government, fiscal devolution, misaligned geographies, and why we're not just doing this faster if there's a capacity issue in Whitehall. Dave, do you want to pick up on any of those?
Yeah, I could pick up a few. I'll start with the geography issue. I think that's a really important point. I think, I guess, as I said right at the beginning of the introduction, from Sheffield City Region made a very clear, conscious decision that its only function was the economy. It wasn't going to get into public sector, wider public sector service reform and so on. And it made that decision because it felt, one, the problem was big enough in itself to absorb the attention. And secondly, because individual local places, local authorities, simply doesn't have the capacity or scope strategically, one, to understand the nature of the problem, and most critically of all, where to centre attention on. So for me, it's less to do with being bounded by your own regional governance, whether that's a local authority level or a bigger level. It's about being able to answer the question, what are we focused on delivering and how do we work with partners to deliver it, in the obviously business, investment and other public bodies where that's relevant. So I think it's much more for me about keeping a focus, not drifting into other areas that are beyond your ability to manage, and making the difference. And I think that is the overriding issue for us. And as long as we keep focused on those things, then there's much more chance to keep focused on delivery as opposed to get lost in the bureaucracy. I don't think there's ever a simple answer to the issue about governance. However local government or national government was structured, the majority of people will still say, I don't understand it, I don't understand how it works. And the issue for me comes back to, at one level, they don't need to. What they need to understand is who represents them and who is accountable to them for what happens within their area. And some of that sort of straight politics has been lost in all this. And in fact, I think chief execs over the years haven't helped themselves, because they've got themselves embroiled in being somehow accountable to the public. Well, we're not. We're accountable to the organisation we work for, and they're made up of people who are accountable to the public. So a mayor or a leader or a ward councillor or an MP are the people who have to make sense of this too and be accountable for the outcomes. And when we lose that sense of that, then we lose our sense of what democracy is intended to be about.
Great, thank you. John?
It's on those two questions of geography and then money. The on the geography question, it seems to me that the economic answer is fairly clear, which is that you want to be joining up decisions on so that businesses have access to the skills they need, so that the people can travel from where they live to get to the businesses, so you've got the infrastructure in place, so you've got the business support available that will help businesses use those skills in the right way. And actually looking at those as a collective at a functional economic area makes a lot of sense, because that's the only way you can join all of those up. Now, clearly that's not the only geography to be considering issues, and that's why Greater Manchester has not just pushed the case for Greater Manchester, but has also been behind a lot of the pushing for the development of the Northern Powerhouse, because there are some issues on infrastructure, on trade, where actually you do need to do that at a different geography. It's just a case of choosing the right geography for the right function. And just on the money question, there's in answer to your challenge, yes, in Manchester we do think we can do things better, and we do say so quite a lot. One of the frustrations, particularly on the service reform side, is not having the flexibility within funding streams to be able to restructure in a different way, intervene in a different way, remodel services. And that brings you back to the money question. It's not just a question of quantity, but also with what strings come attached, and is there the flexibility within that to be able to use it to best effect, which then takes you to another discussion on fiscal devolution and revenue streams. Because if there are sustainable revenue streams in place which can be relied on, it then allows you to take longer term decisions. And it also deals with the success question we mentioned earlier about how do you really embed this over the long term, so that it's not just all dependent on the next cycle of spending reviews.
Great, thank you. Tom?
So Peter's question on should the two-thirds be worried? The answer is no. Why is the answer no? I mean, I think in lots of public policies, but definitely in this arena, you have vanguard areas that are sort of leading the way. And of course they've secured some extra funding and control of budgets, but I don't think it's to the detriment of any other place. What the interesting question again is sort of what happens in May, June, July. Do other areas want to step forward and follow either this model or put forward different proposals for further devolution? So on one level, clearly areas that haven't secured a devolution deal don't have access to the same powers and budgets, but I think there's nothing wrong with being in the second wave sometime if there is a second wave. On the GLA, I mean, we kind of come to this point a few times, and it's not detail I put up, but the model of these mayors does have partnership and collaboration absolutely baked in. So the GLA has a more formal scrutiny role of the Mayor of London, but there isn't an equivalent to the combined authority made up of the leaders of the component and constituent local authorities. And many say the GLA model, actually the Assembly isn't that good at scrutiny compared to how it could be. So this is a different experiment, really reflecting the negotiation we had with Manchester, who wanted, well, I'm not sure you ever wanted a mayor, but you agreed to accept a mayor in return for devolution, but on the basis of a model that was deliberately different to the London model. And I think we will just see which of these, or how they play out. I think the other point that I just wanted to make is that the thing that, again, I didn't say in the outset, but perhaps is sometimes not said enough, is this has been a deliberately cities-based agenda. Not exclusively cities-based, but deliberately cities-based. Because in this country, a apart from Bristol in the west of England, our cities underperform the economic growth performance of the country as a whole. And it's something that started under the previous Deputy Prime Minister and Greg Clark's leadership with the original city deals, but Jim O'Neill's report made the case for. So we have been pretty unapologetic about the focus of this agenda being both on cities, which speaks a little to Peter's point, and on economic powers. But as I've said several times already, I don't think 4th of May is the end of the devolution story once we've got mayors in office.
Great, thank you. Martin.
Just try and pull some of those issues together then, don't repeat what others have said. So in terms of where we are, I can only speak authoritatively about the West Midlands. Is it deep devolution as we sit here now? No, it's not. Is it significant or even partial fiscal devolution? No, it's not. Functionally devolve certain things, significant move in favour of decentralisation and different mature relationship that Tom and others have spoken about. And people have heard me say this before in the West Midlands, in terms of the devolution journey, if we kind of end there, then the question if posed is it sufficient? Then the answer is no, which then leads us to, so what are we trying to achieve over time? And I think the narrative needs to shift, and Tom knows my views on this, in the sense of we have got ourselves into a bit of a corner, we being probably central government and places, around devolution deal boxes. Was it big? Let me give you a secret in case those aren't close to it. A £36.5 million revenue gain box for the West Midlands was not based on some deep algorithmic econometric analysis of why £36.5 million could do what it needs to do. Let's just be honest about that. It's the real politic of being able to understand where you start from, and rather than going box by box and whose is bigger than others, and I'm going to come back to that in a moment, think about what you can then do as you then move towards more power, more fiscal devolution, and create a kind of incremental sense of trust, power, exchange of power between the centre and accountability, success, all these questions that have been posed. Because for me, you know, two final comments, the natural logical consequence of devolution is not just ultimately fiscal devolution, where, for example, the West Midlands is control of its own freedom with regards to the notion of a West Midlands pound and exchequer that understands deeply the distribution impacts that has on the rest of the country, but also necessarily we then have an understanding of going back to the Public Accounts Committee type notion of accountability in terms of regulation, accountability. We create our own environment, because with that direct accountability through the mayor, a fiscal devolution over time which creates the headroom both in terms of fiscal powers but the ability to do a lot more than we've been able to do in the past, but also yes, an accountability for success, for me it all goes hand in hand, which links to my final point, which I think we just need to talk about a lot more. Having come from an industrial strategy piece, what's in front of us, and it's really interesting with sort of Sheffield GM on the panel, we could construct it other ways, what are we going to do about the notion of zero sum? What we're really going to say about this country is we think about winners and losers, sectors that grow, geographies that do or don't get on this massive growth potential. Are we going to say it doesn't matter? Or are we going to have a conversation about the fact, if you think about fiscal devolution, my thought has always been there is something specific and unique about an economy and a growth environment in the West Midlands, but also there's a lot that's in common with our friends up in the Northern Powerhouse, our friends in London South East, although that is a different economy heated in a different way. So just imagine those mayors again, going back to them, on day after the election, or maybe a few weeks into their 100 days, they start lobbying much more coherently, rather than the notion of a London Finance Commission meets the Northern Powerhouse Finance Commission, meets the Western Midlands Exchequer Commission. We start to understand those things that won't tip us over a fiscal edge, but can be actually maturely reconvene and reimagine again the finances for a much more devolved settlement in this country. I've got the answers to that again, but I think that is the conversation we need to get into.
Great, thank you. And we've just got time for one final round of questions. There was one in the front here, one right at the back, and one right in the corner. So can we just start here, please? Thanks.
Paul Dossett from Grant Thornton. The Office of London Mayor has been able to create a great narrative around that role in terms of success around transport infrastructure, obviously the economic success of London, which obviously claims some credit for. How are the Metro Mayors going to replicate that, match that, demonstrate the sort of scale improvement that London Mayor claim credit for, and then have the democratic legitimacy that the turnout for London mayors clearly demonstrates?
Great, thank you. And then the question right at the back.
Nick Quinn from Transport for London. Just building on Martin's point just now about collaboration between mayors. How much is there going to be collaboration between the authorities underneath them? We've done a lot of work with Manchester, we've started with West Midlands as well, on not reinventing the wheel in each place. We have a risk of doing that.
Great, thanks. And the final question, just over here.
Robbie Tilliard from the Behavioural Insights team. I was thinking one of the most important facets of the new mayors is actually setting the administrative precedent for future mayors about how an office is run, how policy is delivered through each of the mayoralties. I just wondered, in the councils that are currently, the greater combined areas, and also Whitehall, is anyone really thinking hard about day one mayor enters the office, what do they do?
Very, very good question. John, I'm going to come to you first.
So last question first. Yes, I'm definitely thinking hard about day one and what happens when the mayor comes through the door. And actually, I think there are, partly answering Nick's question at the same time, there are lessons there from what's happened in London and how the London model has devolved. I mean, to be honest, I think there will be challenges both for the mayor to get a grasp over what machinery is available and how decision making processes work, and where powers lie and how soft powers can be applied. We discussed earlier there are definitely going to be challenges for officials as well, who are used to working in certain ways in certain environments, to adjust to something which is much more political, I think. And I said drawing on my Treasury experience for a moment, one thing I noticed, a big difference between local authority and combined authority versus compared with central government, is how different the political element is, and how certainly in a government department, politicians are much more closely involved in the day-to-day decision making and policy development. And so I think there'll have to be an adjustment on both sides there. I mean, Nick is quite right about collaboration between authorities. Some of those networks are already in place. I'm thinking of core cities, key cities, Northern Powerhouse, but none of them seem to yet quite fit what you'd need to for that flow of information, the exchange of experience round a group of mayors and a group of combined authorities. So I think, yes, there is a challenge there to work out how that network operates and put it together.
Right, thank you. Dave?
I certainly think there's a great deal of collaboration already in the system, and I do think that people in general who are involved in combined authorities have cut their teeth over the last few years in how to work in a different way with each other. I think it would be an incredibly interesting dynamic when a mayor comes in, to the degree to which they can use that existing collaboration in a way that adds value to it, or in fact whether it causes some disjointure in terms of how things work. I don't know. Time will tell, obviously linked to personalities and the rest. But I think that will be an incredibly important moment for the to managing that transition is a key element of what the administration has to do. So those of us who are already organised to support the combined authority and the LEP, and we'll be supporting the mayor, our big task is not just the structural arrangements that surround that, but obviously how do we manage the process by which we retain the collaboration we already have between local authority leaders and officers, and how do we build into that the leadership of the mayor as the chair of the combined authority with specific functions, and how do you do that in a way that keeps the momentum and doesn't take us back? And that's the issue that we're most preoccupied with.
Great, thank you. And Tom, what about this question around the kind of narrative and building that narrative that London's done so successfully? And indeed, what kind of support is there going to be on offer for mayors from day one?
So, I mean, just one thing about London, which is always interesting and important to remember, it was shrinking. London as a city was shrinking until the very early 90s, both in terms of its economy and its population. And it's hard to think about London now in that light. And I don't say that everywhere across the country is going to experience the same renaissance, but if you take the sort of approach that London took, which isn't just down to the mayor or the GLA, a whole heap of things. It does show that places that were, where people didn't want to live and work can change. So that's an important context. I mean, I think mayors will do exactly as you sort of say yourself, which is to take the very best lessons, not just from the London mayor, but actually internationally in terms of all of those leadership qualities that we've talked about. Some of this, again, is going to come to life. As I said earlier, the manifestos are being published. They variously have their first 100 days there by 2020. I want to be held to account for these things. And I think that's where that narrative will flow. And then we're doing a lot of work. We're not directly doing sort of capacity building. We regard that as an issue for local leadership, as Dave has already said. But with the Institute here, with the Local Government Association, with Bloomberg, with a whole heap of others, the Centre for Cities, the Core Cities Network, to try and get the very best pooled brain power together to get mayors and their officers off to as good a start as possible. And I'm sure that ministers will want to engage. We haven't worked out quite how that will happen, but David Davis is already on the record saying that he wants to engage the new elected mayors on questions surrounding, obviously, the Brexit process. And that shows the sort of role that they might have as conveners of sort of place opinion in relation to the national challenges that we face.
Great, thank you. And finally to Martin.
I think the narrative question is a really important one. There's not a ready-made narrative, so it's one that any of the mayor will need to start creating through the manifesto, and that's happening. Goes back to what we said earlier on about the notion of, you know, whose shared story it is anyway and how collaborative and distributive that's going to be. The more mature mayors will be brilliant at being able to almost combine that very much clear storyboard with that which is already in play, which we talked about earlier on. But let's no one misunderstand the challenge here. You've got, you know, my neck of the woods, you know, 3-year period whereby for that first mayoral term, the first 100 days will come and go really quickly. So where are the early wins? Because there's a question about legitimacy and the effectiveness of combined authorities, as well as the mayor wishing to get a second term for the mayoral model to carry on. Which links to the bit about administration. That's a really perceptive question. I'm spending a majority of my time, quite rightly now, 6 weeks to go, with all the mayoral candidates, all of them, across the piece, just to ask those detailed stuff around, could you imagine a completely perverse set of outcomes whereby the mayor, whatever colour, on May the 5th, we're looking at each other, there are separate officers, the Police and Crime Commission has a whole set of cost to serve superstructures, the combined authority ditto, all the local authorities, the mayoral office in policy, communication, project delivery terms feels completely different and distinct from those bodies. Without the need to make it completely convergent, you need to allow political space, get that. And that's really detailed conversations about budget, who. But I think the thing that's really interesting is it's going to take us some time to think about this cultural realignment. Grown-up people eventually get to the point of a sensible set of arrangements for how we don't create chaos and we converge over time. The cultural shift that I suggested right at the beginning is going to be profound in terms of the impact in working relationships for officers, understanding lines of responsibility. Chief Exec is a good example. The Chief Executive for the Combined Authority will report, quite rightly, in terms of the model, into the Mayor and then into the Cabinet. But that again is a distributed model in a way. So but the relationship between the seven Met leaders and the mayor can't be sorted out by joint post or it's about personalities and culture. Then a final bit, because I think we've picked this up a few times around the collaboration. I think this is kind of conversations that Tom and I, a number of other colleagues centrally and locally have. Something is changing. When the whole Devo stuff started, I know GM were ahead of the game, but when the others kind of got in behind it, there was this kind of almost adversarial nature. Come back to the zero-sum game. Even good friends within local government, known each other for years, were not showing each other's deals. Not because of commercial confidence, just because of a sense of, let's keep it separate for us. If you just set back, this is nonsense. In a world post-Brexit, which is going to require a more coherent UK PLC than ever before, and the London and the South East continuing to drive forward its economic success, the Midlands in the way that we've talked about, the Northern powerhouse, unless we start understanding conversations with government, with ourselves, in a much more global way, rather than inwardly, then I think we're absolutely stuffed.
Great. Well, thank you, Martin. On that note, I'm going to draw things to a close. And I'd just like to say thank you again to Grant Thornton for supporting this event. Please do look out for the third and final event on our website. Details to be announced shortly. And please, can you join me in thanking our fantastic panellists? Thank you.